So, Kinderlach, we're getting ready for Pesach. You'll be getting a long vacation, which you all deserve. You all put in a long winter. I think you start your vacation on Thursday, huh? Good for you. And I'm sure you'll help at home. Either help or stay out of your mother's way. You need to understand that it gets very stressful for the ladies before Pesach. So sometimes, even if the kids are playing quietly, the mother can get a little agitated. She may suddenly burst into the kids' room and yell,
"Do you think it's right that I should be doing all the work? And you see the house is upside down, and you're not even offering to help? Is that what they taught you in school? I'm sorry."
And the kid says, "It's okay, Mommy. I understand. You don't have to feel bad."
"Oh, well, that's not what I meant. Never mind."
And so the kids come to help, and a minute later the mother screams,
"Oh, please, stay out of the way. Please just go to your room and play. The biggest help is if you just go play and keep away."
And the kid's thinking, "Wait, Mommy, that's what we were doing before. We were staying out of the way. And you came and yelled at us that we should come help." But of course, the kid is smart enough to keep quiet. And sometimes the husband is sitting around like a klutz, making an even bigger mess in the kitchen. And the wife screams,
"Hey, Reuven, you know, Reuven, the biggest help you can do is by going to the base medrash and learning. But really learn, okay?"
And the husband doesn't feel too good about himself and says, "Okay, fine, fine, I'm going to base medrash." 45 minutes later, he's back in the house, and the wife,
"Oh, Reuven, what are you doing home?"
And the husband says, "Well, you said if I go to base medrash, it's a help. So I went to base medrash, okay? Why, how much am I mechuyev to help already?"
Now, Kinderlach, this doesn't happen so much. What we're about to say, you know, the yelling does happen. That has to continue until Mashiach comes. I'm talking about something else that hasn't happened, Baruch Hashem, for a long time. And that is that when the wife is cleaning, she goes into the closet and sees an old pair of smelly shoes.
"Ugh, gross. I don't even recognize these shoes. Where did it come from?"
And she picks up the shoes. It's so heavy. And attached to the shoes is a stuffed pair of pants.
"What? Who is this kid? Ah!" "How did the stuffed Purim costume? Well, it could have fooled me. It looked like a real person."
But then she thinks, "Hold it. Maybe it is a real person." She feels the kid. She pulls his hair. It looks like he's sleeping. And then she sees a puddle of blood under... Ah! This kid is dead. She panics. She freezes in shock and screams to her husband,
"Reuven!"
In the meantime, Reuven is making himself a chametz tikka lunch in the kitchen. And he screams back,
"It's okay, I kept away from the Pesach. I put on a tablecloth. It's not going to get chametz dick. Don't worry about it."
But she screams even louder,
"Reuven! Reuven! Come fast! I need you! I need your help!"
And he yells back, "I thought you wanted me to be a Beis Medrash, huh? Okay, I'm coming. Whoa, whoa, whoa. What happened?"
He comes to the closet. Kinderlach, tomorrow you're all going to the matzah bakery. Maybe if there's time later, we'll talk about the mitzvah of matzah, and we'll speak a little bit from the Chasam Sofer and other Sforim, some secrets about the mitzvah of matzah. But I want you all to tell me, what is matzah made out of?
Very good, flour and water, nothing else.
But do you know that there are millions of people in the world today who think that Yidden use the blood of Goyisha children to put into their matzah? Now, of course, that's ridiculous. But for thousands of years, since way back, since the Mechiras Yosef, Goyim believe that Jews kill a Christian child and use his blood for our matzah. And Nebuch, this lie has been told over so many times that even some non-frum Yidden were convinced of this narishkeit, and they believe it's true. It's happened hundreds of times throughout the years, right around Pesach, that the galach, the goyisha priests, would find a child, they would kill him, and they would make it look like the Yidden killed him to try to get the Yidden in trouble. This is called a blood libel. Not too long ago, there was a blood libel, a very famous case that's called the Mendel Bayless trial. It was right before Pesach. The year was Tofresh Ayin Aleph. On April 2nd, 1911. Maybe one day we'll take some time and we'll learn how to convert the dates. Whenever you see in a sefer a Yiddish date, we'll show you how to convert it and understand when that comes out in English. It's not so difficult. Bli Neder, we'll do it another time. This story could have happened anywhere that Yidden live today in Golus. At the time, most Yidden lived in Russia, where the body of a 12-year-old boy was found lying dead in a field near the city of Kiev. Kiev is our shtetle in Rusland. A few hours later, the local police in Kiev found the people who killed him. The murderers actually belonged to a gang of Ruskis, a bunch of drunk mishagoyim. But the Russian government, the anti-Semitic rishoyim, decided to take advantage of this terrible murder. And the fact that it just happened to have taken place right before Pesach, they decided that they're going to use this to stir up a nasty blood libel. You see, governments lie to the people all the time. It happens all over the place. It's always been like that. It happens here in America too. Presidents lie all the time. And so immediately the government spread the word that they suspect that it was a Jew who killed the boy in order to use his blood to put into the Jewish matzahs. It took the government a few weeks to find a korban, a person to blame it on. But right before Lag BaOmer, the government found the person that they were going to pick on. There was a brick factory in Kiev, not too far from the field that the dead kid was found. And in this factory worked a manager by the name of Mendel Bayless. And one afternoon, on a regular work day, the doors to the factory burst open with a mob of Russian police. They found Mendel Bayless. They grabbed him and threw him into prison. It took the government many days and weeks and months to fabricate Baba Mises and try to build a case against Mendel Bayless. In the meantime, Bayless was kept in jail. And Jews were asking questions. Is there going to be a trial? What's happening? Thus began the blood libel of Mendel Bayless. Finally, on October the 8th, 1913, over 2 years later, in the beginning of the freezing Russian winter, they schlepped out Mendel Bayless and dragged him from the dungeon to the courthouse to begin his trial. Of course, over the past 2 years, the newspapers and the government, all the goyim were talking about was how the Jew Mendel Bayless is being held under arrest. And soon he'll be brought to justice for what he did, for killing the Christian child. All the Yidden from around the world, in America, Canada, Eretz Yisrael, Europe, wherever Yidden lived, we were davening and donating money for lawyers to help Mendel Bayless in every way they could. Now, of course, the government planted evidence to try to prove that Bayless is guilty, and they did everything they could to make it look like he did it. The prosecutors, the ones whose job it was to make the case against Mendel Bayless, they said that they found his glasses at the site where the boy was killed. They found the kid's blood all over Bayless's clothing, and so on and so forth. Of course, it was a bunch of lies from beginning to end. But the tzaddikim, the gedolim of the time, realized something. The whole world was following the trial. The gedolei hador understood that the government is going to try to use this trial as a platform to bring up everything that they don't like about the Torah, every chazal that they don't like. They're going to try to make an issue from the psukim and the halachas in the Torah to try to show the whole world that Yidden are bad, that Yidden like to kill goyim, and that we think we're allowed to kill anybody we want. Of course, it's all baloney. It's the furthest thing from the truth. Now, they're going to use all this directly against Mendel Bayliss and try to have him killed. But for the Rishoyim, this trial was a lot more than poor old Mendel Bayliss. It was more about creating hatred around the world against Eden. And so one of the Gedolim, who was going to attend the trial and speak to the judge and jury, was Reb Yankif Maza, the Moskovy Rov, Moscow, which is the capital of Russia. Reb Yankif Maza met with Reb Meir Shapiro. Anybody know where Meir Shapiro is? Very good, that's right. The Daf HaYomi, and also the Roshiva of Chachmei Lublin. And together they discussed some of the things that the government is probably going to make an issue out of at the trial. One of the concerns that the Gedolim were worried about was that the Goyim are going to try to make trouble to misinterpret a pasuk in Tanakh, in Sefer Yecheskel. The Navi Yecheskel says, in the name of Hashem, the Eibishter said, Ve'aten tzoyni, tzoyni marisi, Odom atem, you are my sheifalach, my kindalach, you are a mensch. And the Gemara explains in a few places, Reb Shimon Bar Yochai used to say, Aten kruyim Odom, you Yidden are called Odom, ve'ein umos ha'olam kruyim Odom. The Goyim are not called Odom. Now this drasha of the Gemara is not implying that Goyim are not considered human beings. Of course that's not what the Novi is telling us. And of course Goyim are people. The Gemara is using the drosha of the word Odom for certain halachas. For example, a Goy isn't metama the same way a Yid is metama. The dead body of a Yid gives off more tumah than the dead body of a Goy because of the drosha of Odom. This is one of the droshas. There are more droshas. It's a Gemara in Bometzi, Yevomus, and Krisis. That's what the Gemara is telling us. But the Gedolim, the Tzadikim, knew that the Rishoyim, the anti-Semites, are going to want to drey this to mean that the Torah is telling us that we Yidden consider the Goyim not to be human beings. So we Jews must think that we're allowed to kill Goyim. And Avada Mendel Bayliss probably killed a kid, and all Jews are dangerous murderers. Now, of course, this couldn't be further away from the truth. It's ridiculous. But the Gedolim knew that the anti-Semites are going to bring up this Chazal and distort it to use against Mendel Bayliss. Reb Meir Shapiro told Reb Yankif Maza a beautiful and an emes pshat that he should tell the Goyim at the court. And Reb Yankif Maza left Lublin and arrived at the trial. Sitting there in the center of the courtroom was a weak, frail, and sick, innocent Mendel Bayliss. And the Rishoyim, the prosecutor, and the judge began bombarding Reb Yankif Maza with all sorts of different kashas against Yiddishkeit. And Harav Maza stood there for many, many hours, patiently explaining to the Goyim every chazal that was bothering them. At one point, the judge turns to Reb Yankif and says,
Reb Moza, tell me, you consider us Goyim to be like animals? We're not like human beings. Your Bible says very clearly in your book Yecheskel, your Novi, your prophet, he says, in the name of Hashem, Aten Kruin Odom, and your Gemara explains this to mean that all the rest of the nations are not called Odom. That means that you consider us to be like animals. So of course your people kill Goyish children.
The judge ended his rant, and it was Reb Yankif's turn to answer. Your Honor, before I answer your charge against my religion, I want you to please tell me something. I know you have many friends throughout the government. The prosecutor right here is your very good friend. Tell me something.
If your friend got hurt and he's in pain, does that mean you're going to feel his hurt? The pain that he feels?
The judge looks at Arbenkiv Maza
and he says, of course not. That's impossible. Maybe I will feel bad for him, but I cannot feel his pain. The pain that he feels, that only he can feel. I cannot feel that pain. We are not the same person. We are two separate people. So this question is ridiculous.
Rebyankov asked, but 1 second. Your Honor, what if part of your own body hurts? If you have an earache, does your hand say,
I don't care, it's only the ear, that's his problem?
I don't believe your hand would say that. You probably would.
But the judge interrupts him while he's laughing.
Rebbe, what's the matter with you? If I feel pain, this is all part of me. Because it's all attached to me. I am one person. You cannot compare this to my friend who might be in pain. He is not part of me. Rebbe, you don't understand the difference between one person who feels pain in part of his body and two separate people. You know, Rebbe, I am surprised at your intelligence.
Rav Maza looks directly at the judge and says, Your Honor, I happen to know that there's a family in your neighborhood where you live that the husband died. And his widow, the almona, and the children are all starving. They don't have any money, no one to take care of them. They don't even have heat in the house. It's freezing cold. Tell me, Judge, how much do you care about them? And the judge stared back at Rav Maza
and says, happens to be that they are my neighbors. And I have to admit, I never even thought about it, not even once. But Rebbe, what is your point with all this?
Now it's quiet in the court. All the anti-Semites were already listening. And Rav Maza continues, what about the other person, also in your neighborhood, who had a stroke recently and can't walk very well? Do you know if there's anyone caring for him? Does anyone shovel away the snow so he can leave his house?
And the judge said,
you know, it's very funny you should mention this, because that person is my other neighbor to the left. And again, I admit, I never think about it. Never. I never feel responsible for this. This is not my fault. This is not my concern at all.
Says Rav Maza, so Your Honor, now you understand why you Gentiles are not called Odom. Odom means one person. You Goyim are not one person. All of you are your own separate people. You cannot feel another person's pain. You're not attached to the other person. That's why you're called Anoshim, Bnei Odom, many. Because you're certainly not one Odom. But you need to understand that by us Yidden, it's not that way. Do you know right now, as we speak in this courtroom, every single Jew all over the world is praying for Mendel Bayless? Thousands of miles away, Jews who don't even know him are crying for him. This is what it means that we're an Adam. All of us are one person. If one Yid is in pain, we all feel the pain. So many Jews contribute money to pay for his lawyers. They donated money to help his family. Jews who don't even know him, but they cannot continue living their own daily lives because he's on their minds. You see, he's our brother. Countless Jews took upon themselves
more good deeds, mitzvahs, in the schus, in the merit of this Jew sitting right here, Mendel Bayless. And so, Judge, Your Honor, you should realize that we here in exile, in Golus, Zubrochen, Zustochen, you hate us! You goyim do to us whatever you want! It's Hefker! You made a Baba Maisa about an innocent man, and everybody in this courtroom knows it. So now every Jew in the world is hurting together with him. That's the nature of the Jewish people. Now, Kindalach, it was a long trial that slept on. After enduring another 3 more years of suffering, the court announced a verdict. Mendel Bayless was declared innocent and finally set free. It was a tremendous nes. Now we have to realize that today also, here in America, it's no party. Every single day.